that one is not born but becomes a woman, and trying to indicate the constructedness of femininity and debunking the biological determinism. So in a similar vein, I also put it that men too are not born but are made. Okay, and R.W. Kahnale also wrote in her book Masculinities that there is not one model of masculinity but rather multiple masculinities. Okay, and why we have never talked about masculinities is because of somewhere or the other we find the fault lies in the feminist movement. So the feminist movement was in a way great in terms of making a distinction between sex and gender. And we know that sex does not determine gender, and there is a difference between biology and the socially constructedness of gender. But it has basically talked about how the woman is being constructed or the femininity is being constructed. Okay, and but limited attention has been focused on men and masculinity because they were considered to be very straightforward and unproblematic. Okay, so masculinity is most often unseen or unnoticed, you can say, because it is taken to be the norm and never thought about unless in opposition to something else. Okay, but a proper understanding of the field of power in which women have lived their lives demands that we look at men as gendered beings too. Okay, and that is why I bring this question of what constitutes manliness. Okay, and how masculinities are socially, culturally, and historically shaped, and how are masculinities formed, and what contributions? Basically, the main issue is what contribution about these understandings of masculinity makes us to for the shaping of the Indian men today. Okay, so if you see the education structure, the curriculum division, or the sports, they all reinforce a gender dichotomy. Okay, I remember my college days. I think Prabhati would also be knowing that when during the college days when boys used to take sociology. Okay, so people used to say that why you are taking a discipline which is something which is like very feminine, or psychology. So in my college there were a lot of girls who had taken sociology, and we had only 3 or 4 boys who had taken sociology. In psychology there were only 2 boys who had taken sociology. So how the discipline itself is gendered. Okay, and I remember Maitri Chaudhary also writes in one of her books that boys who take sociology are perceived to be different in inverted commas. Okay, so that difference is something which needs to be problematized and which needs to be understood. Okay, and that is why we need to problematize this idea of men being a homogeneous group of oppressors, and masculinities needs to be understood through variables such as class, caste, age, nationality, and identity. So there are a lot of intersections that goes on in the construction of masculinity. And that is why some masculinities are more honored than others. Okay, and while others such as homosexuality is in a way stigmatized and marginalized. So masculinity is both hegemonic as well as marginalized, because on the one hand, we find masculinity talking about domination of over the woman. It is not only about the woman but also domination over those men who are different. Okay, and this dominant masculinity stands in a relationship not just to femininity but also to those ways of being men that are seen to deviate from this ideal man. Okay, so when we are talking about patriarchy makes this man superior. Okay, but when we are talking about masculinity is rather the process of producing these superior men. Okay, and that is how we need to decode this concept of masculinity. But this contemporary understanding of masculinity, I believe, must also relate to its history. And that is why we need to understand how, in the historical perspective, masculinity was constructed. So we all know about the Enlightenment period, how a division was being made between the scientific and the rational, and being unscientific and the irrational. So this realm of knowledge was very much crucial for the making of the gender identities as well. For example, men become characterized as non-emotional and rational, and women as their opposite. Now the colonial era was also particularly important in the career of modern masculinity. So colonialism, what it did, it consolidated this hegemonic masculinity by combining the valorization of science, the feminization of non-European people, and the role of males in expressing their masculinity. Okay, but it does not mean that colonial masculinity influenced the identities of the colonized only. Rather, it gave them a shape or an understanding about their own masculine identities. Okay, so the making of the British male identities during the 19th century, it cannot be understood in isolation from the events and processes of the colonial era. For example, there was this British public school, which was very crucial in the development of what has been termed as the muscular Christianity. Muscular Christianity and moral manliness, through which colonialism created the ideal of moral manhood. And that defined the essence of British malehood. Okay, so this British public school basically emphasized on the physical powerless. Okay, so the physical power was established and the opposite category was created. And we were in the opposite categories. And these natives, that is the we, the Indians, were feminized. But not all the Indians were feminized. Others were also represented as martial races. So this martial masculinity was also associated with Indian masculinity much before the colonial times. Okay. And that is why these martial races were given a kind of respect in the colonial discourse of masculinity. But they were not regarded as equal of the British, since they did not possess sufficient intellectual prowess. So on one hand, they categorize those who are having physical power, they are much more masculine. And the martial race, which has the physical power, they were considered to be masculine, but yet not given the status of equality or being an equal man or equal to the British man, because they did not have this intellectual prowess. So this idea of martial races changed according to circumstances. And the taint of effeminacy fell most heavily upon those sections of the native populations who were seen to have formal education of a similar kind to the rulers. And we know the image of most popularly the effeminate Bengali men. Okay, and that shows or reflects a kind of interplay between power and structure, because it creates hegemonies which transforms the indigenous ideologies of gender and power. Okay, for example, if you have read Passage to India by E.M. Forster, Passage to India, the story revolves around Dr. Ajiz, okay, who is an Indian doctor, and then with a female character who I am forgetting the name, the female character who is a white woman. And this white woman comes to see the Malabar caves, and both of them enter into the cave, and within the darkness of the cave, what happens is not being told, but the woman claims, after coming out of the cave, the woman claims that I have been raped by Dr. Ajiz. Okay, now it was a kind of hallucination. Okay, it was a kind of mental boundaries or prejudice notion that the white woman had about the Indian men. And that is how the story is being written. Okay, how the native African and Indian men were seen as hypersexual, whose sexuality was a threat to the virtuous white woman. Okay, so how this white woman is always in danger from such unchecked sexuality, thus creating a justification for the colonizers to check and discipline other cultures. So this is how the colonial masculinity created this concept of Indian men, but at the same time, it also reflected back upon their own masculinity. Okay, so that is why colonial masculinity influenced the identities of both the colonized as well as the colonizers. Okay, and in response to that, we have the nationalist masculinity. Okay, so what happened in this nationalist masculinity? If you remember this film Mother India, for example, why is it Mother India came? Why there was this notion of Mother India? Now, most of you would be knowing the history. Christian Mayo was one of the anthropologists who wrote a book, Mother India. And over there, she talked about how there is child marriage in India. And in order to remove that image of uncivilized and uneducated India, okay, this concept of Mother India was revisited again, okay, and there was a valorization of this image of Mother India. Similarly, in terms of masculinity also, the nationalist response to the British characterization of this Indian effeminacy was to both to provide a proof to the contrary, as well as embark upon the measures of improving and rejuvenating the Indian masculinity. So, what were the process involved in this rejuvenation of this Indian masculinity by the nationalists? Is that instead of interrogating the colonial model, what the nationalists did is they agreed with the premise that Indians, they lacked manliness. Okay. And they sought to rectify this defect through various means. Okay. And in order to revise and reconstruct nationalism, they started accepting the association between science and masculinity. Not only that, in addition to the project of making this Indian mind masculine, there were also efforts at institutionalizing new regimes of physical education. So there were a lot of akhadas that came up. Okay. And there were a lot of akhadas where they do these kustis. Okay. And in these akhadas, the physical education through which the male body could restore its lost masculinity. And Mahatma Gandhi gave this call of preservation of the semen. So the semen anxiety that the moment you lose your semen through masturbation, that will take away your masculinity. Okay. And that is why you have to preserve the semen. So the physical activity was emphasized in making of a new masculinity that would contribute to the nation building. Okay. And at the same time, there was a demand by the women rights organization or the women's movement for freedom and equality. And that left the men confused about their roles. So the dependent housewife model of the family was something which was questioned. And one of the questions that came to haunt the men is, how is it that they are going to prove their masculinity and superiority in these changing circumstances? Okay, so if you see this picture of this circus also that took place, we have a man fighting with a tiger. So again, emphasizing on Indian masculinity. So this was all these efforts were strategically done as a nationalist response to the colonial construction of Indian masculinity. Okay, so to move further, where does it leave us about the masculinity when it was represented in cinema? Why I'm talking about cinema over here is you can see the similar pattern in television as well as in advertisements, in health magazines. Okay, but why cinema is very much significant for me is because the role Indian cinema has played during the national struggles. Okay, and that is how it has captured the Indian public imagination. Okay, and that is why it is no surprise that this medium plays such an important role in the construction of a public consciousness regarding the social and political issues. So, cinema participates in the continual reconstruction of the social imaginary. Okay, and it represents the interplay of the global and the local. So, there has been the trajectories of masculine representation. When I say trajectories of masculine representations in Hindi cinema, it represents in actually it represents the socio-cultural context in which those cinemas were made. Okay, so we have the long history of actors who are featuring as cross-dressing male stars in comic or in song sequences. We have the sensitive lover boy images played by actors like Dilip Kumar or Devanand or Raj Kapoor, which created an altogether different generation of Indian youth who modeled themselves on these actors. Okay, and then this sensitive lover boy image was somehow replaced with the coming up of stars like Dharmendra, okay, who was also known as the He-Man of Indian cinema. Okay, so and this trend has continued with all these hyper-masculinized actors such as you can say John Abraham or Salman Khan or Shah Rukh Khan, how they prove their masculinity and virility to their female audiences by adopting a muscular gym-toned body. Okay, so it has already been there. So these trajectories we see in how it moves from one period to another period. Okay, and that is where Sanjay Srivastava, one of the renowned sociologists in Institute of Economic Growth, he talks about masculinity, how it has been constructed in the cinema as what he terms as the five-year plan hero. Now, what is this five-year plan hero? In the context of the 20th century, Sanjay Srivastava identified a new masculine type, which he refers to as the five-year plan hero. And this five-year plan hero's manliness did not stem from the bodily representation or aggressive behavior. Okay, as we see these days, how male body is being represented, but this five-year plan hero's body was not that much essential, or the aggressive behavior was also not that essential, but rather through a science-based masculinity. And this was represented in the films from the 1950s and the 60s through both the special habitat of the heroes. Like you'll see the heroes in the highway, where you have the representation of highways, the metropolitan places, and not only that, the profession of the hero as the engineer or a doctor or a scientist. Okay, so you see all these kind of images are strategically put in the visual medium, and that depicts a kind of changing India. Okay, because Nehru gave a vision of a developed India. Okay, and in that developed India, which was in contrast to the rural India of Mahatma Gandhi, in that developed India, emphasis was much more given on construction of dams, of the highways, of the modern building infrastructures, and that is how the notion or the call was given, let us change the image of India as it is portrayed by the colonialism. So that is how the cinema also acted as an agent of this nationalist response to challenge the colonial constructions of masculinity. However, in a due course of time, there was the demise of this five-year plan hero. Okay. And there was the rise of Amitabh Bachchan as the angry young man. Okay, and Amitabh Bachchan's masculinity, Sanjay Srivastava says, is what is known as the provincial masculinity. Why it is a provincial masculinity? Because he did not represent something coming from the city, because his provincial male body was related to the skin color, the language and the expression. Okay, so there was a shift in the creative class consciousness. With the lower class, they found an important role both as character and as audience. And Amitabh Bachchan brought to the screen a very significant aspect of small town masculinity. And this small town masculinity was not only in terms of incorporating the lower class, but also was also the first generation consumer. Why he was a first generation consumer? Because we see the Bachchan hero to be indulging in the dance halls, in the casinos, in the airports. Okay, so they have broken the shackles of the savings regime of this five-year plan political economy, and was very much against the state, because at that time when the call for development was there, and at the same time there was rise of unemployment. So there was this image of this angry young man, okay, who does not hesitate to take the law into his own hands. Okay, and announcing as well the beginning of a consumerist agenda. Okay, and the similar kind of provincial masculinity, Ranjani Majumdar from JNU also talks about through the image of Tapuri, how the provincial masculinity haunts these metropolitan spaces through the image of Tapuri. So the Tapuri image is basically challenging the much polished, the elite class that is found in these metropolitan spaces. Okay, but the Tapuri is a homeless person. The Tapuri is somebody who has migrated from the rural areas to the cities and is living in the slums. Okay, and that is how the masculinity is constructed, the provincial masculinity is constructed through the image of Tapuri. And that is a kind of a threat to the urban city upper class masculinity. Okay, and we have talked about all these masculinities that were constructed in the colonial times, nationalist response in cinema. Okay, and but somewhere or the other, there is also a kind of negligence of other kind of masculinities that were prevalent in the cinema. And that is what I call as the muted masculinities. And in these muted masculinities, we find the comedians, we find the actors who are belonging to a particular age, who plays the character of a father or a grandfather, okay, or who is a comedian. So how is it that these masculinities are to be understood or are to be read in the visual medium? Nobody talks about these masculinities. So what has been reinforced through the visual medium is a particular kind of a masculinity, okay? And nobody talks about these masculinities that are existing. And not only that, with the coming up of the globalization and the neoliberal era, we have a masculinity is shifting, and it has given rise to new forms of masculinity. Okay, and we have these advertisements of Ariel or washing machines, which would be showing a caring man, or Raymond advertisements, for example. Okay, a complete man, the tagline is a complete man. So you can become a complete man only when you care for others. Okay, so how there is a shifting in the masculinity or the new models of masculinities that emerge in response to the economic and cultural changes. Okay, so a new man, a softer, caring creature, sometimes labeled as a feminized man, also replaces the hegemonic masculinity. And that also leads to a moral panic about what it means to be a man at the beginning of the 21st century. Okay, so when this image of the caring man comes up, okay, we also gradually find how there is a shift in the representation of the male bodies, and how the shift is from the hairy chest to the clean seven chiseled bodies. Okay, and there is so much of emphasis on masculinity through the representation of the male bodies. Okay, and when we have the arrival or the concept of the metrosexual male, the metrosexual male is the one who is taking care of himself. But does that mean that the core essence of masculinity has changed? I'm not saying that it has changed, that man has become caring, and man, when, but caring in what sense? Caring only about his looks? Caring only about how he smells? Okay, so, or how he looks, how he smells, or caring for other persons? And does that take away the essence of what it means to being a man? Okay, so this is what I give a background of how masculinity is constructed. Okay, and it is within this background, I focused on one such aspect of masculinity that looks into the intersection of identity that emerges for the fat Indian men. Okay, so where does it leave when there is so much of emphasis on the bodies, this chiseled bodies, or the flat stomach, having six-pack abs? Where does it leave those men who are fat? Okay, so I focused on fat masculinities in my work and tried to understand how is it that fat people take cognizance about their bodies. So I conducted a study of a gay website, okay, gay dating website, and found that while the internet and the queer dating websites promote tolerance and acceptance for an oppressed class of men, why I say that these are the kind of liberating spaces, because in some way or the other, where homosexuality is still stigmatized in our society, these sites provide a kind of space of liberation for these fat gay men. Okay, and that is how we need to understand that where does this fat gay fit in the sites that demands strict disciplining of the bodies? Okay, where everybody is talking about a fair, fit and healthy body as the ideal body. Okay, so we need to question what are the ways in which the fat gay men in a culture that idealizes tall, masculine, young male bodies look into there or have an understanding about the fatness. So this site, the login page of this site, if the picture is clear, I don't know. It says, welcome to our community. Okay. Are you able to see the picture which says "Welcome to our community"? Anybody can see, respond?
Yes.
Okay, fine, thank you. Sometimes I have a feeling that so much of silence means everybody is sleeping. Okay, but please don't sleep. At least look at the pictures if not listening to me. Okay, anyway, so when you see this in the login page of this website, "Welcome to our community," as a student of sociology, we know that what the word community means. So the word, yes.
We could see that, you know, the slide with the arrival of metrosexual male, that slide we can see.
Oh, sorry.
Then the next one is fat masculinities. And
Yes. In this fat masculinities and queering the new body. You see a man raising the arms and then below it is written, "Welcome to our community." So this is basically the login page of that website. Okay. And the word community, as students of sociology, we know that it makes one feel comfortable, isn't it? Because it offers the possibility of sharing common names among the members. And it provides a space for the sexually marginalized to connect and interact with each other beyond one's territorial boundaries. So over here, you have people from all over the world. Okay, so in a way, realizing the concept of apadura is deterritorialization, which disrupts the definition of community in terms of its boundaries. However, what I found in this website is that this notion of a homogeneous gay community, okay, that is something which has to be problematized. Okay, because the moment you enter into this site, okay, the possible matches are searched by using keywords like good looking or muscular and tall, Brahmin or Dalit, okay, so which potentially excludes many from the community, doesn't it? So it seemingly develops along the lines of middle to upper class values and propagates a youth gay culture in this site where only specific gay identities have negotiating power. The hijra remains outside this legitimate virtual gay space. So this is the paradoxical function of this web space. It both enables people to connect with each other and also becomes a site of difference. So when I remember how I began this research, I posted in this website that I was looking for fat people confined only to the Delhi region, because that was where the project was based upon. And I chose this particular site. And the moment I put this on the status of the in this site, in my profile, the responses, they came from different parts of the city. Okay. And I remember approximately 50 responses per day, something like that. And they started asking questions like, "What are you going to do with us?" And, "Why are you after the fat guys?" Okay. And they had really funny profile names also, like "fatty guy for you," "beer to bear," or "only for chubbies," "cuddly bear," "fat men for young slim guys," "fat bottom with a place," and "cute Indian beer." Okay, so I had a lot of response, but sometimes you have to limit the sample. And then I, with the ethics of research, tells us that we have to be very much clear about why you have opened that profile and why you want to meet only the fat gay men. So I revised my status line in the profile and I said that I'm looking for fat people who would be interested in an interview about their lives. Okay, and suddenly, all of a sudden, the responses, the visit to my profile, they immediately declined. And my profile was not visited by those who were earlier interested to meet me. Okay, and towards the end, I was left only with 12 participants. And these 12 participants belonging to different religions and different age groups, they were the ones who started talking about their lives and how they perceive their fat bodies. And then when I started understanding fatness as a lived experience, how is it that they perceived fatness? Okay. And most of them, they said that they defined their fatness through the disproportion of the weight of their body to their height. So while creating an account at the website, they could clearly see the categories of body type. So when you are making a profile in this site, it asks you what is your body type. So it has the categories of belly, stocky, slim, average, okay, muscular. Okay, so it has different categories. And one or two categories were the belly and the stocky. And you have the weights also. I will show you just a second. Okay. Do you see this perception and projection of fatness in new media?
Yes.
Okay. So if you see, this is the login page. And after you enter into the site, it will ask you to create your profile. And you have to mention your age. You have to mention your height in centimeters, your weight in kgs, and your sexual position, whether you are top or a versatile or a bottom. And that is how they were in a way thinking about their masculinity and their fatness, how the media is asking them to define the masculinity. And one of the participants, I quote, says that, "Can you see my cheeks are hanging? Last year I was some kgs and I have reduced now. We Dalits indulge in all types of food rich in oil. See, in this park there are so many fat people. I have seen them for years. They do exercise over here and after that they go outside to have street food which makes them fat. They never lose weight, rather become fat." So this is something where we understand how food and exercise becomes the necessary things or factors associated with fatness. And but that is not only the case with one of these participants, but another participant, Harjit Singh, I have changed the names over here. Harjit Singh shares his experience and says that, "My friends," I quote, "my friends call me Motu. Some event tease me, dekho hati aa gaya. See, the elephant has come. I was fat as a child. I remember my parents taking me to doctors. I took all kind of precautions, but nothing helped. I work in an office where everyone is quite fit. The guys have a slim waist and the girls slimmer. I'm not muscular like other guys in the office and therefore become an object of fun. They make fun of me by saying that I should be given a large cubicle in the office to fit in. One burger is not enough for me. I need two chairs to keep that huge bunk. I have never retaliated. It somehow pinches me a lot. And the worst part is I cannot do anything about it. In fact, I don't want to do anything about it now. I'm used to hearing it." So the way the fat bodies are ridiculed or humored, it creates a kind of low self-esteem. Okay. And when this low self-esteem is there, what I found in this website or the gay dating sites, the profile images of these participants usually were headless, huge bodies, wearing an underwear or almost nude. Okay, so they did not want to show their face, obviously. And at the same time, some of them would say that whenever I'm clicking a profile picture, I would try to inhale a lot so that my stomach gets inside. Okay, so that my belly doesn't come out. Okay, and that is how this fatness was being experienced. And that is how they also, these are the coping strategies that they followed, which was very sad. Okay, because it is something where when they could not accept their fat bodies, some of them. Okay, but later on, as we proceed further in this presentation, I'll share the experiences of those who really enjoyed having a fat body. Okay, and Lee Monaghan is one of the scholar, I think the only scholar I have found is who has worked on fat masculinities, and he identifies three types of fat bodies: the beers, the chubbies, and the foodies or the gluttons. Though he also mentioned that these categories are constructions only, okay, and not necessarily mutually exclusive. So it indicates that there is the existence of multiple experiences of this fat masculinities. So when I was doing this reading of these three types of fat bodies, and I saw that in the profile names also they are writing about the fat bodies as chubbies and the beers. So I asked them, how do you differentiate between these terms? Okay, and what they told me was very much interesting. So one of the participants told me, I think I am a mixture of all the categories. I cannot specify where I fit in. You tell me, asking me, what describes me the best? Are not fat and chubby the same thing? Aren't these unnecessary? As Mary John also points out, that how gender has become a donor category for the Indian women's movement. Similarly, the categories given by the West somewhere does not fit in the Indian context. And that is where we need to understand the Indianness of this fat masculinity, how these experiences varies. Okay. And another participant similarly who works in a private company identified which category he belongs to when he says that I am a beer. Beer, a cute beer, in fact. I am cute because I am fair and not black like a beer, the animal. Though I have got raw instincts like the animal. So trying to say that I am fat and I am fair, and this again, the color of the skin also that matters in the construction of these fat masculine bodies. And Somendu, again, another government employee, I have changed the name, a quote, says that beer is, I think, is a Western concept. Even if I have plenty of body hair, I don't call myself a beer. Why should I associate myself with a wild animal which is unclean, walks on four legs, and lives in a jungle? These English educated people, influenced by foreign culture, label themselves as beer. If we translate beer into Hindi, it's called Bhalu. And we call Bhalu generally to those who are dumb, generally in every aspect, and I am not dumb, unquote. So this again tries to make us understand how we have to problematize these Western categories of fat masculinities. And in this projection of fatness in this new media or in this website, we have images of this. These are the images of some of the participants, some of the profile users who have put these as their profile pics. Okay, now when you put these as your profile pics, that in a way marginalize the other body types. Okay, and that is how these categories and the subcategories that Monaghan talks about is being subjected to modification, replacement, and at times rejection altogether. So we also need to understand how this fatness intersects with religion, region. Okay. So somewhere or the other, how fatness intersects with sexuality, for example. So one of the journalists that I talked to, he points out that I was not open about my sexuality. And it was also quite disturbing. Body weight and sexuality kept hovering over my mind. I accepted the reality and started interacting with only people who knew about me and accepted me as I am. Fatness is something which is visible, but being a gay is invisible to others. My parents knew that I was disturbed due to my body weight, but they could never know that I was equally disturbed with the gay issue as well. So it in a way tries to understand how sexuality intersects with this fat masculine bodies. And not only that, but also how it affects the marital life. So one person, he recounts that, I quote, my wife recently told me that she was not sexually satisfied by me owing to my fatness. My manhood, that is my penis, seems to be hidden under the layers of fat, making me feel emasculated. Okay, so this is how the fat body is in a way, or in order to prove the masculinity, okay, has to give a good performance on bed. So the marital life is disrupted because of this fat body. Okay, and the fat body is also hiding the sexuality as well of the person. And the person is so much troubled because not only of the body weight, but also of the sexuality. So what is visible and what is not visible, that needs also to be very much analyzed. Okay. However, as I said that, I found that some of the participants were also very happy about being a fat gay man. One of them says, "I'm happy to be an older fat gay man. My age is not an obstacle anymore. Neither is my body weight. What matters is my class. I have a lot of younger gay men who come to me because they know I can take them out on expensive dates. I don't think that's a problem at all," unquote. So we see that how the masculinity and the fat masculinity over here interacts with the age and as well as the class. Okay. And we have in this site where we have these profiles or the user groups, which says that we love abs and in a way trying to demoralize or demotivate the fat gay people. But at the same time, we find that there are different, altogether a different experience of having a fat gay body. And what matters for this man is that is his class. He says that I can afford these expensive dates, and that is why these younger gay men are always after me. Okay, so the chubbies and the slim chasers, that is the concept that they say that they are the slim chasers. And the slim chasers are often seen as the predatory type of men looking to exploit these fat men lacking the self-esteem. But the person over here, he said that I'm aware of this. Okay, I'm aware that these slim chasers or the young gay men, they try to exploit the fat gay men who are much more wealthy. But he sees it more as a mutual reciprocity rather than an unequal relationship. Okay. And I found also how this fat gay masculinity also intersected with religion. Then I talked to a Sikh man. So a fat gay Sikh man, he shared his experience about looking for a potential partner on the website. I quote, please listen, this is the last quote. I won't bore you more with quotes. So he says, "Being fat is not an issue with me or my partner, but most of the time, what turns them off is me being a Sikh wearing a turban. I put my headless body pictures in the website. The hair on my body is a great turn on for many of the users. But the moment they know that I am a Sikh, the first question they ask is, do you wear a pagdi or a turban? Are you a pagdi wala sardar? When I answer them yes, the communication ends there. They hate the idea of sleeping with a man who has long hair on his head, though they might like hair on other parts of the body. Long hair being associated with female, they perceive us to be more feminine or effeminate," unquote. So this is how the fat gay men, on one hand, they celebrate their body weight along with their sexuality. And on the other hand, they also strive for a kind of perfection. Okay. And there are profiles which would be saying that no fat men will be entertainment, or fat men stay away, fatty uncles are a big no-no. Okay. So all these kinds of text lines in the status line, that makes one feel that somewhere there is a kind of a dilemma within themselves, and they start striving for a perfection, though we know that a perfect body is something which is illusion. And if you see the compliments, like in Facebook, you have these likes and this heart and the care, sadness. Similarly, in this website, you can also give the footprints, and there are different footprints. But what I wanted to emphasize over here is, if you see the third footprint that says great body, okay, and in that great body, you have the emoji icon of a very chiseled body. Okay, so all this creates a kind of a consumer culture that has led to a body maintenance and a disciplining of our bodies through diet and exercise regimes. Okay, so through this website, though it acts as a liberator for this oppressed population, and proves to be a very safe space for the Indian gay men, it also creates little enclaves which systematically keeps certain people out. Okay, and these stereotypes are not merely viewpoints or attitudes. Rather, what Anthony Giddens tells, that these are a form of a social knowledge, practical consciousness knowledge, that constitutes their social worlds through social interaction. So despite, but we also saw that despite the stigma associated with the fat gay man, we should not understand that the cultural domination is complete, like, because those who are stigmatized, they have various ways to resist such messages. So again, this debate between structure and agency that comes up. Okay, how there is a structure that talks about an ideal body, and how the fat gay masculinities, those who are celebrating their bodies, they resist such messages and create alternative notions of manhood. So the fat gay masculinity hints at a collection of ideas, attitudes, and assumptions, which culturally determine the way gay men view themselves as men. So it is not something which is fixed or absolute across time and space, but rather varies in duration, durability, and dominance. Okay, so with this, I come to an end of my presentation. I leave you with these two pictures while I end my presentation, trying to indicate that how the media has constructed a modern slave and has defined a different ways of understanding masculinity, and the concept of manliness always hover around us. Are you man? Okay. So very often we see, or we use in our common sense everyday lives, act like a man, behave like a man, or mard bano. Okay, so what is this notion of mard? Okay, and that is what needs to be unraveled, the different layers of masculinities. Okay, so with this, I rest my presentation and my voice, and I won't bore you more. Please share your comments, or if you have any questions, I would love to answer them.
Thank you so much, Dr. Pranta, to enable us to see that, how much power lies within this particular discipline of sociology, that that helps us not only to explore the basic concept that that we have been doing in our sociology discipline, but also to understand various communities. And particularly when we are much more careful about the gender discourses, that means a lot of the discussions are basically on or around women and feminism, and where some way or the other that there is a research gap that that has to come up to place, because sociology as a discipline tells us that see the reality as interconnected space, right? So the understanding of women, the understanding of the whole idea of feminism is incomplete unless and until we throw lights on that of other complementary aspects of that of the gender discourses. And thank you so much, Dr. Pranta, to take us to that of historical lens to see that how different versions of masculinities have been constructed throughout the history, and ranging from that of colonial era to that of the modern age, where you talked about the whole idea of consumerism, media constructions of various notions of masculinities, right? So how these different categories are also existing as important areas of sociological discourses. Thank you so much to to tell us, or to at least to think about, because I'm sure that our students would definitely would have enjoyed the talk, and they would have a lot of questions regarding the presentations and a marvelous research data presentation. I must congratulate you that the very intense and dense kind of research that you have done, and the conclusion and the results are also marvelous. And I'm sure that our students must have enjoyed that. Now the floor is open for questions and question and answer sessions. So girls, Ananya would take up the questions, you can ask one after another. Yes.
Yes, ma'am. From the above discussion, I kind of I'm analyzing the fact that masculinity, if we talk about it, is both cultural as well as universal, because there is some element of universality to it, but then it moves from space to space, like we were talking during the colonial discourse, and it is changing over the period of time as well. So, do you think this is the reason why it is kind of difficult to interpret it and kind of get rid of patriarchy in that sense?
Okay, a very valid question, Ananya. And what I was trying to emphasize was how this concept of masculinity has to be unraveled, okay, and how there has been different ways of understanding masculinity. But it should not mean that as if one form of understanding masculinity has replaced the another form of masculinity. So there is a simultaneous presence of multiple masculinities in our society. Okay. And patriarchy is still having its strong foothold in the society because there is this concept of masculinity crisis. Okay. So when this crisis comes in and people then again start to protect that image of masculinity. Okay, and that is how patriarchy never loses, will never lose its foothold. Okay, even we will have multiple versions of masculinity, patriarchy will still dominate because of this crisis. You have to save this crisis of masculinity. So in order to save this crisis of masculinity, okay, so there will be multiple projections of masculinity. So that is why I said that when this consumerism came up, for example, and we have images of men also who are doing the household chores, but does that really take away the reality of our everyday lives? Okay, that does not take away the reality of our everyday lives. We are still entrenched within a colonial discourse, a nationalist discourse, okay, and a media discourse that keeps on telling us what it is to be a man. Okay. I hope I have answered you, Ananya, because your facial expression tells me that you have not understood anything.
No, sir, I did. It is okay. Kind of a system, and so it is just existing over a period of time with transformations. True.
And whenever there is a threat to the system, people will again try to protect that system. Okay.
Yes, sir. This reminds me of that line you used in the presentation itself, when you were talking about the colonial discourse, that when women started to ask for their rights and their everything, the crisis kind of took place at that moment, and that is how it existed even after it.
True. Any other questions, comments, or share your experience also? I think sociology students always should share their experiences.
Hello, sir.
Yeah, hi, Archita.
It was a very nice presentation, and it's a topic that should be more talked about. And sir, I just wanted to present my views that I think that the masculinity, notion of masculinity, and this whole LGBTQ idea is more of a psychological thing than natural. So maybe that's why people are so reluctant to adopt it, because they don't think it's natural, and they think it's, moreover, it's ruining the natural order. That's why they are not accepting it. So, sir, what are your views?
Very true, I think, Archita. It's moreover a psychological thing. You have rightly pointed out. I hope if you have gone through the recent news where same-sex marriage, how the court decided to decline this plea for same-sex marriage, saying that it is something against our culture. Okay, so again, this who is defining this culture? Okay, and who constructs this culture? As a sociology student, we might not agree with the statement of the Supreme Court. Okay. But these days you cannot also protest, isn't it, against the Supreme Court or against the government. So we have to be very silent, but we know that as a sociology student that this culture is something which is constructed by a particular group of people who would get interest out or benefit out of it. Why is it that women are constructed in a particular manner? Why is it that the homosexuals are constructed in a particular manner? So it was said that it is a mental disorder, or it is a Western lifestyle altogether. But if you see the Indian history, homosexuality is very much a part of the Indian culture. Okay. So that is what makes us question, like, how can the Supreme Court say that it is not a part of our culture or it is against the culture, when we have several texts which bears the testimony that homosexuality was an integral part of our culture.
Very much, you know, conscious about, you know, the ongoing LGBT movements. You know, they have been, you know, doing or taking up initiatives, you know, to kind of popularize. And then, you know, isn't it? I think Saranya would speak more on this, because, you know, they have been in the forefront of many of the these you know movements, isn't it? Okay. University.
Good afternoon, sir. And good sir, I just wanted to, I don't have any question because the presentation, it was very clear and I enjoyed it thoroughly. The only thing I wanted to share from today's experience was we enjoyed it so much. Like it is one of those lectures, we were very hooked on all the presentations. We were just looking and we were...
Thank you so much.
Thank you so much, sir. It was really enlightening for all of us and we are really looking forward for more of such presentations and more of such current topics, because it is such a current topic and we need to talk about it. People don't talk usually. So True. Come and this presentation has also enlightened us of saying ki we need to more talk about it and discuss things openly, like these issues which are considered as very petty or trivial, but it is not. Like masculinities in Indian media, we find it in a very regular term, it's very normal, but it is not. What are the consequences we face, especially being women? We need to discuss about that. So thank you so much, sir.
Yeah.
I mean, the moment you have this masculine figures as the figures, you know, which you should be imitating, so that is also somewhere the other, you know, that is feeding to that of, you know, your own ideas of what is femininity, right? So
both of them are so related.
Also, you know, you know, reframe your bodies, you know, in a more quote unquote feminine line, right? So therefore it is not about men or not about, you know, masculinity and all that. It is also about women and about feminism, right? So
how they perceive men, basically.
We talk about feminism a lot, but then, you know, this one dimensional a perspective would actually lead us to nowhere, right? So we need to understand, you know, things in a totality, and that's what, you know, sociology as a discipline teaches us, right?
And how consumerism also has brought out all this image of masculinity. You go to a shopping mall and you find an entire section of this cosmetics for men only. So and beauty parlors coming up for men. I am living in Rajasthan, in a small town, Kishangarh, this university is located. And they have at least 15 male beauty parlors. Okay, so that shows how the small town masculinity are again attracted by these images and this consumerism.
The whole reproduction of, you know, the masculine eye.
The masculine.
So getting sustained to these consumeristic practices.
Somewhere we also need to think about how the male servants, how their masculinity is being portrayed, and the recently farmer protest going on. During the COVID time, how this migrant laborers, their masculinity is need, that needs to be studied.
Okay. Yes, Saranya, any other questions?
Ma'am, I don't think we have any more questions.
Okay. So we can wind up the session now by thanking, you know, Dr. Pranta, and for such a lovely, research topic, for telling us, you know, the variations or the different, you know, accesses of, you know, doing sociology. And we did sociology through the study of masculinities. And thank you so much for giving us a perspective to look at the world, right? And
thank you so much.
Thank you,
Prabhati. Thank you, sir, Mr. Thank you, Archana, ma'am.
Good afternoon, everyone. Thank you to all for joining. Firstly, I would like to thank our principal, Dr. Kalpana Bakhuni, for her constant support. Thank you to our teacher in charge, Archana ma'am. Thank you, Pravati ma'am, for giving us the opportunity and the exposure. Thank you, sir, for conducting such an enriching lecture and enlightening us. We are all looking forward to more of such lectures. Lastly, thank you to our association in charge, Sharmishtha ma'am, and our association team members, and especially our president, Ms. Sarana Saha, for working extremely hard to make this event a bigger event. And thank you all for joining.